Well, it's done. Well, hello everybody. For those that you don't know me, I'm Hernán. I'm going to talk about things that I learned from implementing refactoring. Okay? You may think that's a crazy idea. Why should I implement refactoring if they're already implemented? But you know, the question or the reason is the same one as to them. Why is he implemented a new UI if one already exists? No? but you know, we're a small talker, we like to do crazy things and we want to reinvent things that are already done.
The same things multiple times.
That's right. So, this is a few short context about refactorings. You may know that William Updike, he presented the idea of refactoring his PhD in 1992. It was all based on C++. But then, I'm not sure when, I thought it was before, but looking at the information, the refactoring browser, here says it's around 97, I thought it was around 94, but anyway, the first refactoring tool that we had was for Smalltalk around that year. The refactoring browser is a great piece of software, we all know it, we have used it for a long time, and it has been ported to all Smalltalk. But quiz. How is that? Well, we should ask Juan. But there is a.
I was waiting for you.
But the reason is that the refactoring browser uses his own ASD representation and his own parser. Well, this is one that at the beginning. So Juan decided, and I think with a. It was a good idea not to add another parser with another AST representation in Cuis, because then you start having, you know, different hierarchies for the same things, and it makes things difficult to understand, etc. But that was the idea. That's why. So what I did is I wanted to use Cuis at the university to teach because it's simple, it's easy for new students to understand. It doesn't have that many things, so sometimes that's important. But refactorings for me were important for students to know. And one part of one exercise at the end of the subject that we teach, it's about refactoring. It's about, you know, you have this system and you have to, you know, you have to be sure that it works, and you want to change the design. And in that part, it takes 2 weeks. It's a 2 weeks long exercise. We use refactorings a lot. So we needed to have refactorings, so we implemented them from scratch. And I took a design decision, or maybe not a design decision, but a decision to not look at how the refactoring browser was built. I said, I should start from scratch and see where it goes. And one important thing was to do it using EDD, yeah, to have everything with automatic with the test, but also to do it in an incremental and iterative way, not only to have the test, but to think in the problem incrementally. Of course, not all refactorings that the refactoring browser has are implemented, but the idea is to have all of them, and other ones that we have in mind that are not in the refactoring browser, like chaining refactorings. That's something, it's an interesting idea that we will implement. But let's see some design considerations the results based on these decisions. Well, first of all, when I was preparing this talk, I said, okay, let's look at the class hierarchy of the refactoring. And as you can see, they're very similar. This one is Cuis, and the other one is File, that is the one that has the refactoring browser. So the hierarchy is almost the same. Even the names are very similar. For this refactoring, that is a rename selector, I call it rename selector. They call it rename method, but then method name, well, anyway. But as you can see, it's almost the same, but for this one. So that's interesting. I don't know. But there is a difference on complexity. The implementations that we have in Cuis, the whole hierarchy has only 17 methods. And the other one has 62. What's the reason? Basically, because in this case, the rename selector name method allows you in the refactoring browser to move parameters around, to change the order of the parameters. But then there are other reasons that are not related with that. But that's the only functionality that the rename method has in the refactoring browser that the one we implemented doesn't have. So how about the main message, the main method? For example, in the change selector, that is the superclass of the rename selector, the add parameter, and remove parameter, that are also the same hierarchy in the refactoring browser, does this. So if you want to add a parameter, remove a parameter, or change the name of the selector, it's always the same. You have to create a new implementer, you have to rename the sender, and then you have to remove the old implementers. That works the same for the set for the three refactorings. And it's amazing to see that in the refactoring browser it's exactly the same. And this is I didn't copy it, okay? But as you can see, it's rename implementers, rename message sets, and remove rename implementers. It's the same idea, same steps. But where do we start to separate? If we look at the rename implementers, that I call it create new implementers, in the refactoring browser you see this code. It's okay, it works, but for me it's a little difficult to understand. You know, the first time you see it, it's like, whoa, you feel like Google says something that, you know, is not that nice. And when you look at how we did it, create new implementers is just a do on the implementers that create a new implementer for each. And I don't know, you see, I think it's a little bit easier to understand. And therefore easier to maintain, easier to copy or to change or whatever. But why is that? The problem I see in the refactoring browser after looking at it a little bit is that they use this parse tree abstract idea. They created this idea of the parse tree that helps them to implement all refactorings. So they created a new abstraction to be able to work with the parse tree of all the method that they want to change. While we are using just the basic meta model messages that Smalltalk gives you. So I think that's one of the reasons. If we look at rename message sends, we see the same. They have this abstraction called parse tree, well, that is implemented in the parse tree rewriter. That is a nice abstraction, but I don't know, maybe it's too much of an abstraction, too much of a generalization. It's interesting in other cases when you want to write your own transformations, but when you're writing a refactoring, specific refactoring, I think it's easier to use, you know, just common messages, and that's all you need. So those are one of the differences from the design point of view. I think the implementation that we have is a little bit simpler and easier to understand and therefore to change, etc. How about the functionality? Well, functionality is almost the same for all the refactorings we have. There are a few differences in how we parameterize the refactorings. For example, one of the differences is that in Cuis, if you want to rename a message, let's say the client needs to deposit leg one, it asks you for this code where you want to apply that refactoring. Let's say I say I want to apply this refactoring in whole categories. But then what it does, it allows you to change and add new implementers or new centers or remove, add or remove. Okay? So that scope that you select here is not fixed. It's just like a helper or a help to start looking at the messages that you want to change. And why is this important? Because, well, when you are working in Faro, oops, and you want to rename that, well, it does it in all the system, unless you are looking only at a specific environment. Yes? You can do the same thing, but in a different way. Okay? I will show you later why the other idea I think is better. So that's one difference in this refactoring. All of the method change method refactorings have the same thing. If I want to add a parameter, let's say, where is balance, if I want to add a parameter, well, one difference between Cuis and Faro, well, I'm saying Cuis and Faro, but it's Cuis and the refactoring browser, is that in Cuis you can enter the name of the new parameter that you want to add. Let's say a parameter. And the rest is the same. I mean, you can say, okay, let's initialize that parameter with one. And this is another difference. Where do you want to add that parameter? Before current balance or as the last parameter? Yes, let's say I want to add it as the last parameter. Now I have to enter the keyword. And now I select where I want that refactoring to be, affected. Okay. And then just refactor. So now we have the new parameter. In the refactoring browser, if you add a parameter, it doesn't ask you for the name of the new object, of the new parameter, and well, it doesn't ask you where do you want to add it. It always adds at the end. But a few differences. Well, I think I made a mistake. Yeah, because I changed a set. Ooh. Anyway. I wanted to check a balance. Anyway. Another interesting difference between the add parameter in Cuis and Faro is that the add parameter in Cuis doesn't affect the format. Oops, sorry, I don't want to show that. No. What I'm selecting. That. Well, it's only one sender. But it doesn't affect how, the senders, the format of the source code of the senders. But in Faro, when you change when you add a parameter, it changes the format of the senders. Was it true? So that's not nice yet. And that was a problem we had at the beginning with the rename, because we were renaming based on the AST. We were changing the AST and regenerating the code, so we were losing the format. And that's really bad because, we love how we shape our code, don't we? And we don't want a tool to change it. So that was a problem because there were people that they were not using the remains because, you know, the code, the format of the code was changed. So the idea was for Nawal to write a thesis, you know, to do some research and change the parser to solve this problem. But I don't know why, one Saturday I got crazy, nothing to do with my wife, and I started to look at how we could change that, and I realized that the parser was already saving ranges of the different AST nodes in the encoder. And why was that? Because the debugger, when you're debugging, uses those ranges to highlight the, you know, when you're doing step over, step in. But that information was not complete. It was only for messages sent. It was not for assignment, it was not for, I don't know, for a return. So it wasn't complete. So what we did was to populate that information with all the nodes of the AST. And that way, changing, you know, that changed completely the way of doing a rename. Because instead of changing the AST, now what we do is we change the source code based on the information of the AST, of those ranges per node. And it's very simple, you know, this is a whole engine of replacing a string with ranges, you know, and what you want to change in those ranges. So if we do that, we don't lose the format of the source code.
You can use still the AST and reaccommodate the nodes that come after. So for instance, if when you rename, you take your rename is shorter.
Yes.
You have to move all the other intervals or the nodes that start.
Well, we don't have to do that because what we're doing is we're copying the source code, but in the places where you have to change something, you say I have to change from 10 to 15 with this new string.
Yeah.
So we copy from 1 to 10. Where is that? Here. So we start from 1, and these ranges are sorted.
Mm-hmm.
So we start from 1, and then we start, you know, copying from 1 to the start of the length range, and then we put the what you want to replace. What's that? I think it's this one. And then we continue copying from the end of the range to the next one. So we're always, you know, copying and not really modifying, and in that way it doesn't matter if it's bigger or smaller, the string that you're changing. I don't know. But it works pretty well.
Okay.
But we can discuss the other idea if you want. It's very simple, yeah. And it's amazing how it works. But what is the impact of that? So when we started to have all that information, you know, all those ranges of the AST, we could say, oh, wait a minute. I don't know if you know how the senders or implementers works. In Squeak or Faro or Cuis, even Cuis. If you are here and you want to see, let's say, well, I don't know if this is a good example. If you're here and you want to look for senders, it will work. But if you have more than one message sent in the line, it won't work. You have to select. Let me look for, let's say here. If I want to see implementers, it works, but okay. You have to look for an example here. Okay, there it goes. I want to see the implementers of that manage. So that's why I have the push there. But if I look for implementers of that, it shows me any satisfied. So if, because it takes all the line and I don't know what it does.
That's the same thing with?
Yeah, in the current version, yes.
Okay.
And the same in Squid. It's the same idea. But if I select it, then it works. But now, with this new thing, let's look for portfolio, this one. If I'm here, oh, it was here, and I select, you know, and that's implementer, it takes the AFD and looks for where the cursor is in, based on those ranges, and then it realizes, okay, the message in, you know, is exactly that's managed, so it looks for implementers of that. So it's a little bit nicer, it works better, as you expect. The same thing for sender. But
you have to regenerate the AST, right? Because it's sorted away.
What do you mean? I mean,
you know the source code and the vitals, and you need to regenerate the AST.
The AST you have to regenerate it every time you want. Yeah.
From source code.
Yeah, from source code. So now, well, now when you look for implementers of something, I take the source code, ask for the AST, look for the node based on where the cursor is, and then I can exactly know what is the message that you are looking for. what's your impact? Well, the rename. Because now we can have information, contextual information on where the cursor is. So in the current implementation of Cuis, if you want to rename, if you come here and say, click, it will say rename temporary. It won't say rename. But now that we have contextual information, the rename will work based on where the cursor is. So if I have, you know, I'm not going to change any satisfied. If I'm here and I say rename, it realizes that it's a rename of the message. So I would say rename it with dash minus one, where, in category, not in category because it's not going to work, rename dash minus one in system, okay? And it renames that message. But if you're here, there is an instance variable, and you do rename, it renames the instance variable. And we happen to have here a class, set div account new, and I'm here and I do a rename, it does a rename of the class. Yes.
This ability to rename, for instance, an instance variable.
Yeah.
Not from the class, but from the source code.
Yeah.
It's very useful for people that following the TDD methodology, because you are not in the class, you are in the
familiar. Well, I don't know. No, what happens to me is that sometimes when I'm reading code and I realize I don't want this, I don't know, instance variable to be called like that, instead of coming here and saying refactoring, rename instance variable, blah, 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 it's easier just to here say rename. And it realizes that it's the instance variable. So it's less clicky. That's the reason. And of course, the same thing happened with temporaries. It's like if I use temp1, temp1, I don't know, whatever. Okay. So if I'm here and rename it, it will rename the temporary. So it's a recontextual rename. So that's an interesting impact on that change that we made on the AST. How much time do I have? Okay, I'm almost done. Those are those things. And now I'm going to show you why I think it's better to ask the scope of where to apply a rename. Because in the talk that I'm going to give on Friday, I'm going to talk about how you can dynamically get type information in Smalltalk. Because it's a live system, it's always running. So you could get all information of the types while the system is running. So I implemented a rename with a type, I call it type, I should look for a better name, but with a type scope. It means that it will use the type information to do the rename. Let's look at an example. Here we have tic-tac-toe. And this message has player 01. So if you look for implementers of that message, you will see that there are 6 implementers. One of them is in the tic-tac-toe. But because this tic-tac-toe is implemented with the state pattern, as we can see here, yes, all the state implement also that message. So if I want to rename only this one, what's the problem? The problem is that it's going to look for implementers of hashPlayer01 and it will show all the implementers, not only of the tic-tac-toe, but also of the states. And the other thing is that when it will look for senders, it will look not only for the senders to the tic-tac-toe, but also for, to the states. So you will have by hand to, let's say, what you name it, and system, whatever. So by hand, you have to say, oh, okay, no, I don't want this one, I think I don't want this one, and then with senders, yes, I want this one, I want this one, but I don't want this one, okay? And that's a problem. That's the problem we have with refactorings because we don't have type information. But now, with the thing that I did, we have type information. For example, if I want to know the type of that instance variable, well, that instance variable was assigned with an instance of plane X, plane O, plane X1, blah, blah, blah. That all of them are subclasses of tic-tac-toe state. Yes? And I can also, well, anyway, I can see implementers of type implementers of this one. It will show me only the tic-tac-toe. And if I want to see the type implementer of this one, it will show me only of the state. Yes? So now, if I rename this message, and I select type, because I'm renaming only the message for tic-tac-toe, it says, okay, I will rename this implementer, and it will rename only the senders of that message. So if I just refactor and now I see the code, this one is still the same. It didn't rename that one because it knows this, the type of this variable. And just to show you that it works, let me do this. I have to run the test to have all the type information. And now, what I want to show you that if I do a rename, a type rename, again, it will rename this one because the receiver itself, but not this one because the receiver is not a tic-tac-toe. So let's rename it back. Those are the implementers, those are the senders, and now, as we see, oh, well, that was a bad rename. Let me do it again. Let's say I want to call it that way. That's three. So, only that message sent was renamed, but not that one. So, you know, the scope now is automatically generated based on the type information. So, yeah, ooh. Conclusions. Sometimes it is good to redo or rethink something that is already exists. Sometimes. Sometimes it's not. But sometimes it is a good idea. And I think it was a good idea because the refactoring browser has a bigger, it was thought as a tool with a bigger ambition than what we're trying to do. What we're trying to do is very specific, very concrete. And I think that's why we have a simpler design that helps us to do this kind of thing very easily. That, for example, that rename, that type rename, I did it today in the morning. You guys over there can say that. and it's good because, you know, it's changing also the current tools of Cuis. So it means that it's not only good for what we're doing, but also for the impact of other tools in the market. Well, anyway, that was all. Questions? Yeah. Not from the agro. Sorry. That was my intention.
Yes. Now the question is, I like this type rename a lot, but it is a little bit logical. Because you, if I understand you correctly, you collect the types from running the test.
Well, from running, not only the test. Ah, okay. It's always, it's a running environment.
Ah, okay. I didn't know that. Okay.
And it's always keeping the type of everything. So I showed that, well, if on Friday I will show it. The problem is that currently if I change a method, it loses the type information. That's why I had to rerun the test. Okay.
Okay,
but that's a limit of
it's
how.
It's just a simple way to get some type.
That's right.
So if you don't have full coverage from the test.
Well. Yeah, but you know, I saw how I solved that problem. Because then you can have sure senders, sure implementers, or unsure senders and unsure implementers. And sure sender implementer is a sender that. It's a sender for that message, but you're not sure if it's correct for that type. Okay? So it's not exactly like a statically typed system, but if you have a good coverage, and remember, Smalltalk is always running. Yes? So you have a lot of information from the type, you know, type information, a lot of type information.
And that unsure sender is a candidate.
That's right.
For renaming.
Oh, for renaming. Well, it depends. It depends on why you cannot take the type information. Sometimes it's because that message, that method wasn't run. Sometimes it's because the hierarchy is not good. Yeah, there are many reasons. Any other question? Yes?
What let you rename an instance variable to the name that already exists as a temporary?
No, it doesn't. Oh, yeah, rename an instance variable to a temporary, it will tell you that. Wait a minute, I think I'm. Let's see. I don't remember how I saw that. But if I want to rename it to 10, 11. Okay, it tells you that, you know, that instance variable will be hidden by the current temporary variable. And the same thing if you rename the temporary variable with the same name as an instance variable. And you can decide what to do. Okay, thank you.